Good morning, good afternoon, good night, and good evening. Welcome to the second session of the Forever series. Last week we talked about doubts. This week we are talking about hope. Hope is a wonderful thing, and we have hope in Jesus Christ, knowing that God has done the most miraculous thing that ever could be done, and that's sending his son Jesus to die for our sins on the cross. This is absolute good and great news. Before we get started, let us take a quick word to pray. God, we thank you for wherever we are, whether we're at home or whether we're in our car, whether we're just checking Instagram and happened upon the Facebook page. God, we thank you for where we are, because we know that where we are, you are as well. God, it said neither height nor depth nor death nor life can separate us from God's love. God, we understand that you love us, and we thank you so very much for that love. God, forgive us for those things that we do that are not according to your will. Forgive us in times that we disappoint you, or forgive us in times that we have fears or even doubts as to who you are. God, allow us to learn through this study, and allow us to learn through the rest of our lives how much you truly love us, and not only take that love for ourselves, but allow us to take that love and to give that love to other people as well, knowing that it is exactly what the world needs at this time. God, we ask this in your name, Jesus Christ's Son's name. Amen, amen, and amen. So today we are going to talk about hope. We are going to talk about hope because hope is something that we see we need in droves in this world and in droves in today's situations in society. So I wanted to talk about this because it's an awesome thing to kind of back up to our Easter presentation and to our Easter idea. So you saw the big idea is the love of Jesus gives us hope. That is a big idea, and that is a big thing. Last week and this week, we'll talk about concepts of forever. But as we talk about forever, I was thinking, and I know of something that goes on forever. It has to be a game of Monopoly. I don't know how many of you guys, I'm sure most of you guys have played Monopoly or have been in a game of Monopoly that lasted seemingly forever. It took forever to get around the board. It took forever to get all the pieces. It finally took forever to get those alliances so that you could actually get the pieces that you need to form your monopolies. And then it takes forever to put houses on the thing. And how many houses do you have to have before you can put a hotel? And then you have to have houses and hotels. And I mean, it's insane. But that can go forever. But what I did find out, which actually we're going to have to play at some point when we get back together, is the game of Speed Monopoly. Speed Monopoly is a game that evidently you can play that game, and it is only supposed to last 2 to 10 minutes. So if it only lasts 2 to 10 minutes, I'm all about it. Let's play Speed Monopoly. Or if you want to, we can play the other version. So how many other things besides Monopoly are things that take forever? When you're hungry, it seems like sometimes it takes forever to get that thing out of the microwave. If it's a Pop-Tart or some kind of dinner or, you know, leftovers, it just takes forever. That 2 minutes seems like it lasts forever. Or even if you're just warming up a hot dog or something like that, it takes absolutely forever. So continue to think about those things that it would take forever to do. So we're going to do a quick poll. We're not going to open up the polling on Zoom or anything like that, but we're going to take a quick poll on several things that you think you could do forever. Again, you can write your responses in the chat on Facebook, or you can just send them to me by way of email. My email address is revcornish78@gmail.com. Again, that's revcornish78@gmail.com. You may feel free to send your responses there, because those are always appropriate. So if you want to send those responses to revcornish78@gmail.com, that would be absolutely awesome. So could you take sunny skies forever? If you could choose anything forever, would sunny skies be it? With thunderstorms? Some folks like thunderstorms. They like rain. They like the hearing of rain because it can give them real good sleep. Spicy food. Would you like to eat spicy food forever? Cereal or your favorite food for every meal. Would you like to do that forever? Some of us like to work out or take long walks on the trail. Would you like to do that forever? Or riding a bike everywhere you go. Instead of taking a car ride, riding a bike everywhere. Would you like to get brand new shoes forever? So every day you wake up, you have a brand new pair of shoes. Eat peanut butter forever. Take naps forever. I'm thinking that naps is higher on my list. Ride roller coasters. So every day you go to a different theme park and you ride roller coasters. Feeling hopeful. Would you like to feel hopeful forever? So we know that only in our dreams do we have an endless supply of cereal or an endless supply of naps. So there's certain things that we can't do, or most things that we can't do forever. And maybe not all of the things that we talked about and listed are on there, so definitely feel free to drop your own in there. But definitely at least one of them, yeah, we could probably consider doing forever. I'm still on that Mandalorian kick. I'm still waiting for the new episodes to come out. I think they might have come out already. But I definitely can watch Mandalorian for a little bit. So similar to the fast-paced, chaotic game of Speed Monopoly, and we'll definitely have to play that, our lives can feel the same way at times. Sometimes the chaos is fun, like when we go on a roller coaster and right before the big drop, you're feeling like, this is going to be insane. But it's interesting because when that chaos is fun, we remember it being exciting at the end, but not so much at the beginning when we're going up and hear the clack, 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 clack before the big drop. Bouncing between friends and activities and new experiences. These are some of the chaotic things that kind of give us anxiety at first, but also give us a sense of fulfillment and happiness and joy. But other times, chaos can leave us feeling defeated and hopeless, like when our chaos is stumbling from one disappointment, one loss, or one frustration to another. Sometimes life leaves us feeling like we can't catch our breath or take a breath, and not necessarily in a good way. So what do we do in those difficult moments? Who can help us in these difficult moments? And where is Jesus when we feel consumed by hopelessness and despair? Maybe Easter seems like a strange time to be talking about chaos and hopelessness, but after all, shouldn't we be celebrating the fact that Jesus is alive? Of course we should, and we will, but the good news of Easter can't help us in the middle of our darkest moments, or can it? Then is it really good news? I say it is. So we're going to ask a couple of questions. I'm going to break out and break down some questions for you. You know the format. I'm just going to ask a couple of questions for you, give you about a minute and 30 seconds to write these questions that you see on the screen down, and I'm going to play, you guessed it, the music. All right, so if you were guessing what part of that music was my favorite, it's the guitar when it comes in. That is absolutely my favorite part of the whole thing. You got about 7 seconds left, and then we will continue moving on. But definitely feel free to pause this at any point. That is definitely available for your use, as this is a video. All right, as we continue through, those questions are really important. So I'm going to talk about a time really quick when I was... feeling kind of hopeless. The time was when I left my mom's house. It was my mom's birthday in September. I was supposed to be getting I was going to Alaska. My job moved me to Alaska. I was supposed to be getting a company to take my truck and my trailer, my 7x14 trailer, and drive it across country. But the closer we got to the date, I asked the company, hey, you guys are supposed to let me know 48 hours out, 72 hours out, when the person is supposed to be coming, and also, you know, what time they're going to be picking up the stuff and what time it's going to be getting to Alaska. And for whatever reason, they never did it. And they never showed. So I was supposed to be taking a flight from Atlanta to Virginia and then a flight from Virginia to Seattle and then Seattle to Alaska. And they never showed up. I felt absolutely hopeless because I didn't know what to do. But luckily, I had some really good friends, or a really good friend, who helped me to actually drive across the country to Seattle, where I was supposed to be getting my stuff on the barge or on a Alaska Marine Lines ship. And I was going to stay in a cabin and, you know, ride with my stuff up there. So the hopeless part is here. About halfway across the country, after about two flat tires, passing through Minnesota, I got a call from the company, and they said that the train or the boat had broken down, and that my stuff would not be getting on that boat, and I'd have to make other arrangements to be able to get my stuff to Alaska. So that's my hopeless story. So last week we talked about some different events. We talked about Jesus's death, and we talked a little bit about the resurrection. But it must have felt very hopeless to the disciples, Mary Magdalene and the rest of the crew, when they were talking about and experiencing the death of Jesus. His followers were full of doubt, they were full of questions and full of fears, and rightfully so. Their savior, their leader, their friend had just been killed. Their lives were probably felt as chaotic and hopeless as ours do sometimes. So in response to the chaotic nature of what was going on, Peter denied that he even knew Jesus altogether. Thomas demanded proof that he was Jesus. Mary Magdalene couldn't even fathom that Jesus would possibly be alive, even though she saw that there was no body in the tomb where they just laid them. So today we're going to take a look at some of the same stories to see if the first Easter doesn't address our doubts, and if it doesn't have the same power to give us hope in some not so obvious ways. So our first scripture that we're going to take a look at today is going to be John 21 through 13. We're going to take a look at John 21 through 13. And just in case you haven't brought your Bible, I brought mine. And the reading in John reads as follows. On the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one who Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciples set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. I guess Peter was a little slow. He bent down and looked in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Simon Peter came, following him, and he went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and a cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in one place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. This is the new part that wasn't on last week. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb as she wept. She bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." So as we look at the story of Mary, Mary was experiencing some deep hopelessness at that particular time. She had already lost her dear friend once, but now his body was gone. She had lost him all over again. Sometimes when we find ourselves experiencing a deep or aching kind of hopelessness, it's tough to see what is right in front of us. In our grief, we feel loss, we feel confusion, we feel uncertain. It's in these moments of uncertainty that Jesus began speaking to Mary. This next section comes from John, the 20th chapter, verses 11 through 18. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw that there were two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying. Yes, we did just read this. One at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid them." When she said this, she turned around and saw that Jesus was standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary?" Jesus turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brothers and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'" Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them he had said these things to her. So we see in this scripture that Mary actually had a very real, a very powerful encounter with God. So who is someone that we have not, who we would recognize anywhere? Is it mom or is it dad? Is it a sister or brother? Are you picturing their face? If they walked into the door right now, you'd recognize them instantly, right? Of course you would. And that's what we find so interesting about this story. Mary literally spent the better part of her life around Jesus, or a good portion thereof, at least about 7 years. And all of a sudden, she didn't know who Jesus was. Mary assumed that someone had stolen his body, because what else could have happened and what else could explain why Jesus wasn't in his tomb? Overcome with grief, she wept. And as she was crying, someone asked why she was crying. She thought the voice belonged to the gardener. But when the man asked her or said her name, she realized, wait, that's Jesus. He's actually alive. Mary had been so wrapped up in her grief that she hadn't realized that Jesus was standing right beside her. Mary didn't recognize Jesus or the hope that he was about to give her, but Jesus never gave up on her. Jesus wasn't angry with Mary because she didn't understand and see that it was Jesus right in front of her. He was kind. He was gentle. Jesus didn't pull away when Mary didn't recognize him. He stayed with her. He called her by name, and he waited for her to see him. Sometimes our hopelessness keeps us from recognizing Jesus is present and with us. But when we're finally able to see Jesus is with us, even in our darkest moments, our hopelessness can turn immediately to hope. So we're going to talk about an activity real quick, but first I've got some questions. I'm going to slide these on and we'll go over these. Have you ever been in a foggy weather or blizzard where it was difficult to see? Have you ever had swimmer's ear or an ear infection where it was difficult to hear anything because you're overwhelmed by your own discomfort or your pain? And have you ever lost track of your friends or family in a crowd where you were distracted by what you were doing or where you were going? So you know what time it is. It's time for the music. It's time to go ahead and get this thing rocked out. Here we go. A minute, 30 seconds. All right, that should be just about enough time. Thank you so very much for that. Sometimes when we're dealing with hopelessness, we don't see exactly what's in front of us. Sometimes that happens to us with Jesus too. We don't see that God has been carrying us. We don't see that God has been taking care of us. We don't see that God has been providing for us, even in the midst of our hopelessness. We get wrapped up so deeply, and sometimes God is sitting right there just waiting for us to notice. So when we face really difficult things, we sometimes lose sight of the fact that Jesus is with us. Other times, we really can't hear or understand what Jesus is saying to us because we're so under pain or so under duress or so discomfort, having discomfort in our situation and in our experience. And sometimes we're feeling hopeless. We forget to even look for Jesus at all because we're so preoccupied. So I'll continue quickly with my story. So I got the call just west of Minnesota, Minneapolis, actually, Minnesota, the land of 1,000 lakes. Look it up, it's there. I think it's like the land of 10,000 lakes, actually. I got the call that even if I had gotten my stuff to Seattle, I wouldn't be able to get it to Juneau because the boat had broken down. And I was so wrapped up literally for about 24 hours into that trip. It took us about 4 days to get there. For about 24 hours, I was so wrapped up in the fact that my stuff wouldn't be there. I'm doing all this driving in vain. I'm not gonna be able to get my stuff when I get to Alaska. I'm gonna be sitting on the, laying on the floor and sleeping on like a blow up mattress. I didn't realize that my first plan to go to Alaska wasn't actually to take my stuff onto the ship and travel with it in the cabin. My first plan was actually to have it carried by barge. There's a company called Sampson Tug and Barge. I remembered after talking to a very close, trusted friend, she reminded me, hey, by the way, don't forget, you know, there's this other company that can do it. And it was only then that I remembered that I had a contact in my phone, even though I didn't have internet at the time because we were like out in the middle of nowhere. And I could call someone from Sampson Tug and Barge. I made the appointment. I was able to get my money back from Alaska Marine Lines, and I was able to, you know, spend the money and secure a spot for my car and for my trailer to get there. So just like our story, we can see that Jesus and sometimes our friends, our family, our loved ones call us out of our point of hopelessness, and this is also good news. So here's the tough part though. Sometimes when we feel hopeless, Jesus doesn't show up, or at least doesn't show up in the way that we want him to. Jesus went to see the disciples after his new life, after his life was restored, but not everyone was there that day. Thomas wasn't there, and when they told Thomas about the story, they were just like, "You're right." Not everyone saw him. Thomas wasn't there, and he didn't get to see Jesus, so he just didn't believe him. And we all can relate. Someone in your life has told you a whale's tale about how a fish that they, you know, caught, you know, one time was this big, and then it got to be that big, and then it got to be that big, where it was so big that you're just like, yeah, right, that never even happened. So most of the people who die tend to remain dead. Why would Thomas be looking for anything else when Jesus was buried? If they were there with Lazarus, they might have seen that. But why would Thomas believe that he would ever see Jesus again? So let's take a look again at John, the 20th chapter, verses 24 through 29. And that scripture reads as this: "But Thomas, who was one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them. And Jesus came, so the other disciples told him, 'We have seen the Lord.' But he said to them, unless I've seen the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I'm not going to believe.' A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, 'Peace be with you.' Then he said to Thomas, 'Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Do not doubt, but believe.' Thomas answered him, 'My Lord and my God.' Jesus said to him, 'Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen, yet they come to believe.'" And this is something that's important. Can you remember how you felt when you were dealing with doubt and uncertainty, and then God showed you something, or through an experience with your parents or your family, you believed what they were telling you, or you saw the picture of that huge fish that they particularly caught. Thomas did get to see Jesus again in that chapter, but it didn't happen right away. Thomas had to sit with his uncertainty, confusion, and doubt for 8 entire days. So can you remember where you were 8 days ago? Think about how much time has passed since then. What's happened in your life in 8 days? Does 8 days from now feel far away? Imagine how much longer it'll be if you're waiting or hoping or wondering if each day that you might to get to see Jesus. And how disappointed would you be if each of those 7 days passed without Jesus's presence? So we're going to ask a couple more questions, and this one is about hopelessness. Have you ever felt hopeless? If so, would anyone like to tell us about it? Talk about it on chat. Text me 770-676-4871, or you can send me an email again at revcornish78@gmail.com. Tell us about a time that you felt hopeless. And then answer this next one. When Mary and Thomas felt hopeless, how did Jesus respond to them? Those are 2 quick questions, so I'm not going to start the time. I'm not going to start the music. You'll have to wait to the end to listen to the whole song if you really want to. All right. So in times that we feel hopeless, Jesus responds to us in a particular way. Well, we have to be sensitive to Jesus as he's responding, and sensitive to God as God responds as well. So Jesus' appearance to Mary and Thomas give us clues about the kind of hope that Jesus gives us. It's not temporary, here one day and gone the next kind of hope, but a kind of hope that lasts our doubt and our uncertainty all the way through. It's a hope that's based in Jesus' ability to conquer death. Because if he can beat death, there is nothing that Jesus and God through Jesus can do. It's a hope that's based in God's great love for us. He loved us enough to send his son to die, and he loves us enough to show up and comfort us even in our situations today. And God will do that, especially when we need a glimmer of hope. So when we're feeling hopeless, we can expect that Jesus will show up in the flesh, just like he did with Mary and Thomas. Maybe, maybe not. But here's what the Apostle Paul said in Ephesians 1:17-18. Paul writes, "I pray that God, the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of the glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints." So sometimes we may not be able to see it with our physical eyes, but the eyes of our hearts can see the hope that Jesus offers us. Just like Mary and Thomas, our pain and our hopelessness don't have to prevent us from seeing what's true, that Jesus is truly alive and his love gives us hope. So we're going to ask a couple of following questions, and then, oh man, we didn't talk about our activity, did we? We'll get to the activity. I'm going to put a couple of questions on that talk specifically about our hopelessness and how we handle it and how we help others with hopelessness. This time I am going to put on the timer because it's about that time. And then, of course, the music.
I'm not afraid to
All right. So we got the questions down, and I realized that I forgot to tell you guys about the exercise. So the exercise should be really cool. You definitely need a spotter for this one, someone who you trust, someone that you can depend on. Parent would be preferred, and always, like any activity, make sure that you ask your parents' permission before doing the activity. So sometimes in life, it's hard for us to find God. With all the distractions in life, you may find that it's difficult also to hear the voice of God or see God in our situation. So remember the words of John 10 and 27, and it says, "My sheep hear my voice, I know them, and they follow me." So this exercise is called, or activity is called, Blind Faith, and we'll need a spotter for this one. So you need a trusted friend or a parent. Parent is preferable. You need a blindfold. You need a room that you're familiar with, and definitely pick a room without stairs. So what you're going to do is blindfold yourself with no peeking. Make sure your spotter is there at all times, not going off to get a Pop-Tart or a toaster strudel or something with you blindfolded. And blindfold yourself in a room that you're familiar with. And then what I want your spotter to do is actually just move pieces of furniture that are not breakable, smaller pieces that you can navigate around in the room that you're familiar with, safely and slowly at first, from one side of the room to the other without any help. And then I want you to try the same exercise with the spotter giving you directions like left, right, stop, go, turn around, back up, that sort of thing. Other versions of this same exercise may include playing some loud music. I would suggest doing it over speakers or like a Bluetooth speaker if you've got it, not necessarily with earbuds, because then you won't hear them at all. And that would kind of defeat the purpose of the exercise. But try that out this week and see how you do. Let me know in the comments, either on Facebook, or you can shoot me an email to Rev Cornish, R-E-V-C-O-R-N-I-S-H 78 at gmail.com. Or you can give me a call or text at 770-676-4871. I appreciate you guys so very much for everything that you bring to our discussions and to our group. And before we leave, we want to pray. Let us pray. God, we thank you for your grace and your mercy. Thank you, God, for being with us, even in times where we have doubts, even in times where we feel like we're hopeless. God, we understand that you are always there, standing with us, trying to help us, God, in our situations. Allow us to hear from you. Allow us to see you. Even with all the distractions that come in our lives, help us to become better disciples and faithful members of your family. God, give us the strength to understand your love, even when your love is difficult and when it doesn't work out the way we think it does. Allow us to love you even more. Allow us to press in even more. Allow us to have faith that much more so that we can truly see the miraculous things that you truly do in our lives. God, allow us to see you in every situation. Allow us to find and locate you. Allow us to be eager to seek you in everything that we do. God, now in the times that we feel so hopeless and so full of doubt, allow us to realize that we are more than conquerors through he that loves us. God, we know that you love us. Allow us to understand, feel, and know that love every moment of our lives. And then allow us to give that love to other people so that they can too know the joy of knowing an awesome and living God. God, as we find our places in different spaces at this time, we ask for blessings for each and every last one of these children, each and every last one of their families, each and every last one of their extensions, God, as they go through their schooling and go through their exercises, riding horses, doing soccer, playing sports, going to work, God, playing tennis, God, allow them to know the safety and security that comes with being in a living relationship with you. God, keep us and protect us, watch over us and provide for us in your will. We pray this prayer in Jesus' precious name. Amen, amen, and amen. Thank you guys so very much. I appreciate you for being here. This week's music was brought to you by, again, Ellie Linebear. We do have some additional information to put up on the screen for our CCL in the eye so that we make sure that we're legitimate, and it's behind my head. So there we go. Well, there it is. Thank you guys so very much for participating. I love each and every last one of you. Be blessed this week. I'm not going to play the whole song. If you want the whole song, you got to go back to last week. Anyway, take care of yourselves, or next time, I may actually just add the link to the song. It probably won't be the same one next week. So, Hope you like it. Hope you enjoy it. Hopefully this has been great for you. Be blessed.